Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Ham Nation is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode of Ham Nation is brought to you by ICOM. For more information, visit icomamerica.com/hamnation. And by DX Engineering. DX Engineering offers practically everything you need to outfit your shack, plus the fastest shipping in the industry. In-stock items ship the same day, Monday through Friday, until 10 p.m. Eastern. For more information, visit dxengineering.com/hamnation.
This is Ham Nation, episode number 291, March 15th, 2017. Randy helps us tune up our oscilloscope. Good evening, everybody. It's Bob Heil. Yeah, I look different, and I know that I'm in a different place, but I'm in a place I love. After all, this is where I spend a lot of my time for many, many years. We're in the assembly plant of Ohio Sound, and I tell you what, they put a bunch of stuff together today. Should come in here in the daytime, I guess, and film some of it, but we'll maybe get into that later. If we have time, I'll show you a few of the things they did. We have a big show to do first, and let's go see what's going on. Don, I tell you what, no, let's go to George and see what George has got first, and then we'll come back, because you and Randy got something cooking, right?
Yeah, hi, Bob, and good to see you back in Illinois again. You know, we always like to get an inside view from the Ohio Sound plant there. That's nice. That's a lot of microphones. Yeah, tonight, Randy's got a video for us on an RF sampler that he's built, so we're looking forward to seeing that, and yeah, we're also looking forward to whatever Don may have, and Dale, and Amanda later.
That's right. They're all going to be here, and Dale's got some good stuff. And, of course, Amanda will be watching all of you in the chat room and taking questions. But let's just kick it off right now. Let's go to Don, because he's got some really cool things. You got a little genius with you, don't you?
I do, yeah, by way of pictures and video. But first, a couple of announcements. Gordon is not here tonight, so he wanted me to mention that in addition to the Ham Nation seminar at Dayton, that our old friend Gordo will be offering a seminar for kids and their teachers and ham elmers on how to make ham radio instruction for licensing more fun in the classroom. They'll, of course, have lots of live demos to keep them all on point. And, you know, kids, that's what it's all about. And John Amadeo, our buddy out there with the Last Man Standing crew, wanted me to mention that the ABC hit TV comedy Last Man Standing will shoot its final episode of the season coming up this Tuesday, March 21st, and to commemorate, the KA6LMS station will be on the air from the Mike Baxter set around 22:45 UTC. You work out the math on that. This season, Last Man Standing licensed crew members and special guest operators have worked well over 1,000 stations in sideband CW and on D-Star, and this Tuesday will be your last chance to work them until next year. Operating times and frequencies will be posted on the Mike Baxter KA0XTT Facebook page sometime on next Tuesday. Now, let's go to the pictures. I went to the Rayne, Louisiana Hamfest, which is around Lafayette, Louisiana. Now, you know it's a serious little hamfest when you see that on the door. Doesn't that look sharp? I mean, those were perforated, so of course they could, those folks on the inside could see through. Next one, please, Brian. And there's Emmett's big antenna that he had set up out there on the W5DDL crank up pole on their trailer. That's his big spider beam from radio waves. Nice stuff. Next one, please, Brian. And of course, the big crowd inside. And this is a unique hamfest because it's Friday and Saturday. You know what's so unique about that? Well, next one, Brian. The unique thing is that they have a little band. And, of course, it's in South Louisiana in Cajun country, so it's a Zydeco band. They play a little Cajun music. And, of course, they got to have a little Cajun food. Next one, Brian. Yeah, crawfish. Boiled crawfish. every ham fest ought to have boiled crawfish. But, of course, you got to have them down here in South Louisiana because you can't go up to Michigan and expect to get good boiled crawfish. But I have not made the Friday of the Rayne Hamfest yet because it's a three-hour drive away. But that's good stuff. Now, I ran into KG5AYI, who is Samuel. He's a young ham. I introduced him to you a couple of years ago, I think. He was the small boy who went to the ham fest specifically to meet me, which I thought was just cool as I could be. As soon as I walked in, like within 5 minutes, he found me. And he was getting licensed. His dad got licensed. They were introduced to ham radio by his uncle. And so did a little talk on camera with them back then. Well, he's in there today. And this is what I find as soon as I walk in the door. Run this little iPhone video, Brian. This is just check this kid out. This is amazing.
All right. There he is. KG5AYI. He is a wizard at these things here. And I've been mixing it up for about, I don't know, 15, 20 seconds. Let's see how long it takes him to solve it. Go. Meanwhile, I'm sitting in the corner eating my crayons again. You gotta be kidding me, dude. You gotta be kidding me. You gotta be kidding me.
Yeah, that's his proud dad. And if you were, I don't know if you were keeping time there, 16 seconds. 16 seconds. And that's not his
that
best
is crazy.
Time. His best time is 11. And he and his little brother, Owen, who is also a ham, they do that, I think, competitively. I'm constantly seeing stuff about Rubik's Cubes, and he'll email me all kinds of stuff on Rubik's Cubes. He's just the coolest little guy. And if you happen to get on Echolink on, is it Tuesday night? Thursday night. Thursday night, they have the Youth Net, and we've had the Wilson sisters on here before, Abby and Kendra in Lafayette. If you get on Echolink to the Youth Net, just search for W5DDL repeater in Echolink. I don't remember the node number off the top of my head, but Thursday night is when they have the Youth Net, and the Wilson sisters call that. And more often than not, you'll hear little Samuel in there, too, on the net. Just a really cool kid, great operator, and a neat family. The whole family is just cool as they can be, so I always look forward to seeing Samuel down there at Rayne. So that's the story from the Rayne Hamfest. Had a great time. Picked up a new antenna from Emmett at Radio Waves. Got a 160-meter off-center fed dipole, so I'm going to be back on top band here before too much longer, and just could not be happier about that. So let's go ahead. We got a full show tonight, so let's go ahead and move it on along and get into the news of the week from Amateur Radio Newsline. From Amateur Radio Newsline Report number 2054, these are the Ham Nation headlines for Wednesday, March 15th, 2017. Ham radio may have just helped launch the physics career of one Indiana teenager.
Maria Lisandru, KD9BUS, is one of 150 students nationally to be named a Coca-Cola Scholar. Maria was selected from over 86,000 applicants. The scholarship program focused mostly on community involvement, which included her music and, of course, ham radio. The senior at Bloomington High School South in Bloomington, Indiana, who is the president of the Amateur Radio Club, plans to study physics next year, partially due to her involvement in the school's ham radio program. Maria explains how ham radio played a role in landing this $20,000 scholarship.
For some of the essays, they were just mainly about leadership and how you've been a leader throughout your community. And one of my communities was that I talked about ham radio. So I talked about how I'm a woman in science and how I go to my research lab and I'm one of the only people in my astrophysics research lab, or the only woman in my research lab. And it makes me want to continue to pursue science because I want to kind of merge that gender gap in science, especially in physics. And so I talked about ham radio and how during contests I'm like one of the only women on air, and how I went to the Dayton Hamvention. Mr. Rapp invited me to the Dayton Hamvention, and he contacted the people there, and I actually talked at the educator forum or the teachers forum, and I talked about how to get more women in science and more women in ham radio specifically. And so I talked about how I hope to in my future to be a leader in ham radio and be a leader for women in ham radio, especially younger women.
Maria will be making her college selection soon as she puts the finishing touches on AP Chemistry. Basking in the sunlight, radiating off of Maria, I'm Mr. App, WB9VPG, reporting for Amateur Radio Newsline.
Maria's brother is Padraig Lisandro, KC9UUS, our 2013 Young Ham of the Year. A founding member of the Hurricane WatchNet has become a silent key.
The Hurricane WatchNet has lost one of its original members. U.S. Air Force Colonel Don K, K0IND, has become a silent key on March 1 following a three-year battle with lung cancer. Don, a native of Detroit, Michigan, and a graduate of the U.S. Naval Academy, served in the U.S. Air Force after attending basic flight school and later became an all-weather pilot. Don's military service lasted from 1946 until 1977. He was known to many as a devoted ham and Elmer, and qualified for his amateur radio license in the early 1950s while stationed in Colorado Springs. He is considered a co-founder of the Hurricane WatchNet, which he joined in 1965 as one of the original members. He was assistant net manager for 23 years and later net manager for 4 years, ending in 1992. He even designed the Hurricane WatchNet logo in the early 1980s. Don Kay was 89. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Mike Askins, KE5-CXP.
For the rest of this week's Amateur Radio News, please listen to the full Amateur Radio Newsline report online on a repeater near you or on shortwave radio station WTWW at 9930 and 5085 kilohertz. And a reminder that the nominating period for the 2017 Bill Pasternak WA6ITF Amateur Radio Newsline Young Ham of the Year Award is now open and runs through May 31st. You can find the nominating form on our newly redesigned website, arnewsline.org, under the YHOTY tab. We'll present the award to a deserving young amateur at the Huntsville, Alabama Hamfest in August. And that's all from the Amateur Radio Newsline, your independent source for amateur radio news for four decades and counting at www.arnewsline.org. With Neil Rapp, WB9VPG, Mike Askins, KE5CXP, Karen Eve Murray, KD2GUT at the news desk in New York, and our news team across the globe, I'm Don Wilbanks, AE5DW. 7-3. We'll see you next time here on Ham Nation. All right. Even though Dr. Scove is not with us via video tonight, that doesn't mean that the solar update is not going to be here. So let's bring those up, Brian, if we could. Here's what she tells me. The remnants of a coronal hole is giving us a little boost in activity this week with elevated wind speeds that could bring active conditions. NOAA is giving us a slight chance for solar storm conditions at high latitudes. Expect only minor issues on the ham bands, if any, over the next 3 to 4 days. Then we get a short break before more fast wind comes in late next week. And the next one, the sun has remained spotless for the past week, but we're finally getting active regions rotating back into Earth view for the next few days. None of the regions are major flare players, so no M-flare risk. M-flare risk remains flat. Solar flux is at the low end of marginal for ham radio propagation. So the new active regions are a blessing for propagation. Expect bands to improve slightly by the end of the week, which is perfect for me because I should have my 160 wire up. If you'd like to follow Dr. T on Twitter, you can do so at Tamitha Scove. And that's a look at her Twitter page with her smiling face and the sun behind her. So there you go. There's your news of the week from Amateur Radio Newsline, a Rubik's Cube wizard, a young ham radio operator, and a happy guy right here. Bob, back to you.
Hey, Don, before you go away, talk to us about what's happening on WTWW there on the big short wave, that your shows that you're on there and all that good stuff. Let's talk about WTWW.
Yeah, I was on last night. Last night was the first Tuesday of the month, and I have a monthly guest with Ted Randall on WTWW at 5085 kilohertz, which we're on tonight, as a matter of fact, with the audio from Ham Nation, also on 12.105 with that monster signal into Africa. But if you're around on the second Tuesday of the night every month, tune in to 5085 WTWW at 8 p.m. Central Time, which would be 0100 UTC. I'm on with Ted. We're usually on for about an hour and a half. We talk about ham radio. We talk about Newsline. We talk about Ham Nation. We pretty much just solve all the problems of the world as we see them. It's a public service that we like to do.
Yeah. So. All right. Thank you. And on Saturday night at 8 o'clock Central, I play a theater organ concert. So tune
you
in.
You do. And that is, he was telling me, that is wildly popular, by the way. So
tell me how stuff. That box loads up. So tune in on Saturday night. That's always fun.
Yep.
All right. Well, I have so much stuff here, and I've only got about 12 minutes to do this, but let's see what we can do here. This pine board project is really becoming popular. I'm getting so many emails, and I thank you for it. I got one from Tom Alisi, a K1TA. He's the president of the Greater Norwalk Amateur Radio Club in Norwalk, Connecticut, and he wants to bring this as part of the club project. That's really great. I want to do one other thing before we really get into this, because I got some interesting stuff. I've talked about it before, but electric radio, if you don't get this, get it. It's really great now. It's a lot about restoration and so on, but you'll learn a lot. But this month is a whole thing on the Mosley receiver. Let me get it up here. The Mosley receiver, you know, we talk about it. We've had several things with interviews with John Clemens, but this tells the whole story, and you'll enjoy reading it about the Mosley receiver. And all you got to do is put ermag.com. Send them a note. Get involved with that. It's really fun. Well, we have some things to talk about. And what I'm going to do here in the plant, I don't know what happened. The other camera didn't work, but this one will. I'm going to make you a little seasick here for a minute. We're going to take you on a little ride. Get down here so you can see what we're doing. I have the power supply that we built. And one of the things that I did purposely, I left out a part. And I left it out purposely. I didn't say anything about it. It wasn't a contest. It was just to see how many guys were paying attention. And there were some of you, and thank you. You get the award. What was that part? This. A fuse. And in the whole design of the thing, if you remember, I've got to watch it because this is plugged in. We have 110 volts and 110 volts. But then here is the switch to turn it on. And this spare terminal is to wire in the fuse. My idea is to use a fuse that has leads on it. But there's all kinds of ways to do the fuse. You can do it in line or what have you. But during this whole project, everybody, use your own discretion, your own idea. Make things happen. See, that's the fun of homebrewing. We don't have to stick to the plan because there really isn't a plan. We show you what to do in the schematics, but get in there, do it. And I also have to tell you, I was so thrilled to get some comments on the wonderful, Ham Nation, we should patent this and the chip stick. But wait a minute, there's something extra. What is that? Well, that came from KA7TPH. And it's a great idea because he was saying that he used these in his work years ago. And it's really tough on the capacitors just to short them out. You saw how that worked last week. We're going to do it here in a minute again. But if you put, and it isn't any big deal. I had a 220 ohm resistor that works fine, but I put a lead on it. So what we're going to do here, turn that little booger on. Gosh, you didn't get to see the light. That's purple, by the way. But watch what's happening here with the meter. She's coming right on over to 200 volts. Now, we're going to turn it off. What's going to happen? Wait a minute. I'll even unplug it. It's unplugged from the wall. Wait a minute. What's happening here? What's happening is these capacitors have stored that charge up. I tell you before, I told you many times, and I will repeat it each time. I got a couple of nasty notes from guys. Oh, my God, you're going to kill somebody. No. That's the warning. That's the warning. Come on. We're growing up guys and girls, and we're building things, and you're playing with some voltage. What are we going to do with that? Chip came up with a great idea. We're going to couple this to the ground lug over here, and I'm going to go over here and touch the capacitor. Watch what happens to the meter. It slowly goes down. That's because the resistor. And it's not hard on the capacitors at all. Okay. We'll turn it back on. And I have the meter on the output of it. And here she comes. It's charging the capacitors. That's why it just says come right on, because it's charging those caps. I'm going to turn it back off. It didn't go down, but it will when I touch the other end, the positive end of the capacitor. Down it goes. You be sure with any kind of, I even do this to my 12-volt supplies. Don't let the capacitors hold the charge. Take them down. I always use a clip and a couple of resistors, but Chip came up with this great idea. Thank you, Chip. K9MIT, thank him. He's on the chat room in there all the time. And what a great idea he had. But now we have a little addition. So there you go. There's nothing but a piece of wire, a resistor onto the clip lead. So, again, it's just a safety part of things. Because I'm going to do something else for you. You see, all capacitors have the charge situation. That's what they're there for. But now I'm going to do something rather interesting for you. I have a 9-volt battery. And I have an electrolytic. And we're going to match up the minus to the minus. And we're going to put that little baby right across that 9 volts. Get in there. Okay? Going to switch the meter back down to 10 volts. And we're going to put that booger on there and watch what happens. Okay, there's 9 volts. Just as thought. Now here comes the cap. There's the minus. Wait a minute. The battery's here. Where's that coming from? Told you. We've charged it, and you can't just go away and leave these things. So we're going to take our old chipstick, and we're going to make it go away. But you see, it'll go away a lot faster because we only had 9 volts. There again, you have to maintain safety, and that's what we're trying to do here. And the other thing that we're working on, and in the coming weeks, we'll have all the other parts and stuff, but we've got, and a lot of you mentioned it, and I appreciate any comment, good or bad. I want to hear it because we're all learning, of course. We're going to come out of that power supply at, took the chipstick and died. And we're going to build us a bleeder setup. These are resistors. And because of that, we can have different voltages. This, of course, is ground. And we'll be getting into the size of resistors and so on. One of the reasons I don't know yet is I have to get all of the other parts together. That's why, if you remember, there are extra terminals on the screw strip on the output. That's where we'll mount the bleeder resistors. And these guys will allow us to bleed that down. We won't have to worry too much about the old chipstick, because that'll be bleeding that plus voltage down. But We need to have different voltages. We'll be able to do that. And that's how you do it. All your transmitters and receivers, they have power supplies just like this. They'll come out of the rectifiers. Bingo. Way you go. And the other thing that we're going to work on is I'm going to work on the filter because depends on how it all comes out. We're going to work on that B plus a little bit. You see, what we have now coming out of that, just the capacitors, the rectifier and the capacitors, what we have there is a situation that it's 200 and some volts, true. But guess what? It looks like this. Well, we don't want that. We want to filter that better. You can just count 60 cycles, 120 cycles, whatever. How do we do that? We do that with filter networks, a big choke or more caps, and we'll figure that out. But what we're going to do is we're going to cut the tops off of those babies so that we don't have that ripple effect. That's what we do with power supplies. We have filter networks and all kinds of other things that make sure the voltage is not going to hum and buzz and crackle. And we'll get into more of that as we go. I'm working on the mic preamp now, and I'll keep bringing you some of these great things that we're doing. And I want you all to follow along. But no matter what happens all through this project and any project you do, you want to make sure that safety first. That's so important. And I have the camera over here. I've had a lot of guys ask me again, showed it last week, but here it is again, where the parts came from and what we need to do for the power supply. There you are. This is the basic power supply. There will be other resistors and stuff, but this will get you going. Notice here, one fuse holder. Everybody missed that last week. I did it just because I could. And the vacuum tubes we're going to need, 6X5s, 12AU7. And those come from a really great company called vacuumtubes.com. They really have great tubes at a really good price. Antique Electronics is going to be your main supplier. They have everything. You go to that site, I guarantee you, you will spend sometimes hours. Man, they have everything. So for all you guys that say, oh, you can't do that, Ohio, because you can't get the parts. Oh, yes, you can. And they really have a great catalog of antique electronics. Well, to us, it's antique for some, but not for us. It's everyday stuff. And then I like, remember the ceramic tube. That tube socket's great. I love that tube socket. So do you, don't you, George? That is a must. And those come from esrcvacuumtubes.com. And I guess you could get your vacuum tubes there, too. He has a lot of things also. So there's a great list of parts and the suppliers. So no excuse. And there's the diagram again. We'll continue to go through some of it. One thing I'm going to point here in the last. When you're looking at antique electronics, if you really want to get into it, they have a kit. It's a power supply kit. And I would advise everybody that wants to get into building a little more, it's fine to build what we're doing here, but this son of a gun has voltages from, I think it's 150 volts all the way down to, I think, 3 volts. All the different taps. It's kind of hard to see on this little thing here, but these are all outputs for different voltages. There's, I think, 3 regulators in it. They're using solid-state rectifiers. Check it out. K101A. Everybody needs a bench supply, and this baby is it. I really think you should take a look at that. And they have a, almost like the old Heath kit. Check this out, George. Is this cool? And guess what? It's built on pine board. You get a board. Do you know about this, George?
No, I don't. I have not seen this before.
Oh, man. Yeah, it's just really fabulous. And there again, antique electronics. There's a diagram for it. Give you a little better insight. And I think it's like $40.
Oh, really?
Yeah, 45. I think I'm right on that. It isn't very much money. My gosh, the transformer costs more than that in most cases. But I love it. There's all the voltages. Did I get that on the camera right? 22, 45, 67, 90, and 135. And then there's also 1.2 to 6 volts. So what a great thing. So there you go. Antique electronics, man, they're your people. I mean, they've got some wonderful things going on. Make you seasick here again. But I'm just, you know, I'm a builder. I love building. This, what I'm standing in here is because of what I did when I was 15 years old. I got into building, and so many of us did. And I just invite you to get going with us. And we'll come back after a while. If we have time, I'll show you some of the other stuff. We're not here for that tonight, but I get a lot of requests. So while we're hooked up, we'll go. So we'll be back here and see what happens in a little bit. Amanda's down the line and so on. But for right now, George, you're going to talk to us about ICOM, huh?
Yeah, we'll be right back and talk about what we're going to be giving away this month. But, let's get a message now from ICOM.
It's time to put away those winter boots and spring forward with ICOM. Base stations, mobile transceivers, handhelds, and more, ICOM has all the equipment to help make your spring full of adventure. Get out and get mobile with ICOM. Communicate with the touch of your fingertips. Perfect for small spaces, the IC7100 is the ideal D-Star option to help communicate anywhere. Angled control head and touchscreen for quick intuitive operation, large internal speaker for clear digital audio, and it's perfect for multi-band and all-mode communications. Do you have spring travel plans this year? Back for a limited time, the IC7200 is a great option for hams wanting a device to carry out into the field. Simple and tough with IFDSP, digital noise reduction, and USB port for PC control. Ideal for the ham on the go, try the IC7300. It's a high-performance, innovative HF transceiver with a compact design, RF direct sampling, 15 discrete bandpass filters, large 4.3-inch color touchscreen, real-time spectrum scope, SD memory card slot, and more. Visit icomamerica.com/amateur for more information on all ICOM radios.
And you can tune in and enter to win after each episode of Ham Nation. Go to icomamerica.com/hamnation. Register to win some great swag prizes like T-shirts and hats. While you're there, learn how you could win in the monthly grand prize drawing for a radio. For March, that's going to be the ICOM ID 51A Plus 2 dual band, dual watch, VHF, UHF handheld. It does analog and D-Star, has a built-in GPS receiver, DV and FM repeater list functions, an independent AM-FM receiver, and you can get a free Android app for it as well. So go to icomamerica.com/hamnation after this and each episode and register to win. Sign up, good luck, and don't forget to follow ICOM America Inc. on Facebook and Twitter. And Randy has been back at the workbench again and up to it. Let's see what he's got for us this week.
Hello, Randy, K7AGE. I've been working on my BitX40, doing a little bit of transmitter work, but I needed to look at the RF output on my oscilloscope. So I've been thinking about what to do and the easy way to do that, and maybe as an opportunity to build another little piece of test gear for the shack. And I remember that Alan, W2AEW, posted a video about 5 years ago where he built a little RF sampler. And it has two outputs. One's just an attenuated RF output tap, and the other output is a simple AM demodulator tap using a couple diodes. So I have Alan's schematic here from his video, and we've drawn that here into my own version. So basically, the way this works is that you have a straight through path. It doesn't really matter which is input and output. It's just straight through. And the two outputs, the first one is the RF sample output. And basically here, it's just a simple resistor divider with then a capacitor. So it's AC coupled going into your scope. And on this other output, it's an AM detector output. And basically, there's a capacitor that picks off the RF, a couple 1N34A germanium diodes to rectify the RF, which would basically, with an AM transmitter or sideband, give you the audio. And then a resistor and a capacitor. And here's the output for that. Parts value for this is fairly non-critical. I have the little input capacitor. I have the 47K ohm resistor that'll be used there. And then I have a 920 ohm resistor for that position. In my junk box, I didn't have a 10 puff capacitor or a 10 picofarad capacitor, so I have a 27. So that'll do fine for that. I do have a couple 1N34A diodes, germanium diodes. And, of course, 1K resistors are really common. And I don't have a 1,000 picofarad capacitor, but I have one that's 1,570. So those are the parts I have, and that's what I'll use. So I'm going to build the probe into a Eltoids can. Surprise, surprise, QRP builder's favorite little chassis. So I've mounted four BNC connectors, one on each end and two on the sides, and with the idea that I'm going to use this heavy piece of wire, and that's going to solder straight through here for the pass-through, and then I can just bridge off the pass-through wire with the components going over to the BNC connectors. So, time to warm up the soldering iron. Okay, first thing I'm going to do is gonna put some solder on the center pins of these BNC connectors. Heat that up and kind of fill the little area there with some solder. One done, do the other. I'm going to tin the wire, heavy-duty wire. This is enameled, coated wire. So I've used a utility knife and scraped the enamel off. So I'm just tinning each end here. I'm going to tin a couple areas in the center. Okay, I'm going to get in here and see if I can get this soldered in here. Heat that up. The wire looks like that's taking. I can see it go from shiny to dull, so it's cooled down. And now I'll solder on the other end here. So I soldered the two resistors and the capacitor together by wrapping the capacitor's lead around the resistor lead. So that's ready now to install. Okay, so I've got the parts in the box. I've taken the leads of the resistors on each end and wrapped them around the wires here. So they haven't been soldered yet. And the capacitor down here, it's formed up and ready to solder there. So I'm ready to get in there with the iron. And since this is a lot of heavy soldering, fired up my little fan here so to keep me from breathing this stuff in. So let me get in here and solder this resistor. Here we go. It took that one nice. Helps tinning these wires first. And here, solder this wire. There it goes. I can see the solder flowed. And I think the resistor lead is tucked up into the center of the BNC. So a little bit of solder, and I've got that one. Okay, now for the parts for the output side. The capacitor and the two diodes mechanically are kind of like the two resistors and a capacitor over here. So the capacitor is going to come off the center, the diode. You have to pay attention to the polarities now with the black lines. So these three components will go from ground to the hot line, and then on the other side of the diode will go to the center pin of the BNC with the other capacitor and resistor to ground. Okay, I have everything mechanically installed in here. Nothing's really soldered. Here's the capacitor picking off from the RF coming in. Here's the junction of the diode to ground, the other diode going to the center pin of the BNC, and with along with the resistor and the 1570 picofarad capacitor to ground. So, okay, get in here and solder this stuff up and solder the diode junction and solder the center pin and solder the capacitor onto the feed-through wire. Okay, I have it all done here. Everything looks to be in good shape. So let's hook this up and do a quick test with it. Okay, let's give this a try out and see how it works. I have my BidX40, power connected here, speaker here. Here's the RF sampler box. With the connectors on the end, it allows me just to use a male-to-male BNC adapter, so I can hook it right onto the radio. And on this end, I have a 5-watt, 50-ohm dummy load. And this port here, or that output there, is just the resistor tap off of the RF. And, of course, the other one has the diode. So let's take a look at the scope here. Okay, we're looking at the resistor tap, and we see two things here. One is my voice modulation, and the other is a voice modulation is filled in with the 7 megahertz RF signal. So let's move it to the diode tap and see what it looks like next. Okay, now the scope has been moved to the detector output, and you can see the RF has been removed, and you just see my voice waveform there. So, okay, well, I guess that's a wrap. The little box seems to be doing its job. Give me a little piece of test gear here. I can look at what's happening with the BidX40. So thanks for watching. This is Randy, K7AGE73.
Well, 73, Randy, and good to see you back with some soldering action there. You know, we really like to see the solder, especially when you see the smoke rise like that, and you can just imagine what the aroma is like in the room. Well, for rosin core, I don't care too much for the smell of what I use these days. The no clean flux, but, you know, it's you don't really have to clean it very much. So, compromises there, but great project there and perfect for when you're doing some experimenting. Pull out the oscilloscope, take a look at your modulation, take a look at your envelope there. Great project. Matter of fact, I think we've done that here before. I built mine into my tuner. Why not? I didn't feel comfortable running a kilowatt through an Altoids 10. I guess you could, but, you know, those are the kind of things you need. Simple to build, easy, and useful. Well, you know, last week we were looking at the speakers that I had replaced the surrounds on. We looked at the crossover network in there, and we saw a light bulb. And I asked, you know, what is that light bulb used for? Well, I got an answer from Doug Wilkerson. He says it's used as a power limiter or a fuse. The resistance of the filament goes up as the light gets hotter, and that dumps some of the power into the light bulb rather than into the tweeter burning it up, thereby, you know, acting as a power limiter. And that is correct. I've had PA speakers before that had those built in there and actually have blown a light bulb before. That was scary. I thought I had ruined a horn in my speaker, but no, just blew out the bulb in there. And yes, depending on the speakers, you may see it light up behind there on the cone or particularly around the surrounds if that bulb goes off. Well, congratulations, Doug. AA0DW. DX Engineering is going to be sending you one of these nice DX Engineering silkscreen t-shirts. If I can put it on the right side. It's got the logo on the front, silkscreened. It's also got it across the back, real big. Very comfortable t-shirt. So thanks, DX Engineering, for doing that. For next week, I've got another question. This one comes from Gordo's 2015 through, 2019 General Class License Guide. A great book that I, you know, recommend for when you're doing study for your ham exams. This one, on which of the following bands is phone operation prohibited? And you should know this one. 160 meters, 30 meters, 17 meters, or 12 meters. If you think you know the answer to that, well, send an email to me, hamnationcontest@gmail.com, and you could win this MFJ Guardian Angel Surge Suppressor. They come in SO239 connectors to fit your PL259s, as well as Type-N connectors, and a variety of, well, in those two varieties right there, you can get them to handle up to 400 watts PEP or 1500 watts PEP. So if you think you know the answer to the questionnaire, which of those HF bands can you not do voice on? HamNationContest@gmail.com. And now it's time to, well, let's get Don in here. Don, speaking of DX engineering.
Yeah. Yeah. In fact, I just happened to look on my little tiny cluttered up operating desk. And what do I have? I have the Autumn Winter 2015 DX Engineering Catalog. And I have the Spring and Summer 2016 DX Engineering Catalog. And I have the Autumn Winter 2016 DX Engineering Catalog. And even though the Northeast may be socked in with snow right now, here we are in March, which means it ought to be just about time again for a spring-summer 2017 DX Engineering Catalog. So I'm waiting for that. Always look forward to the new catalog. They'll probably have it at Dayton. In fact, I'm sure they'll have it at Dayton. Well, because springtime is on the way, even though, you know, the folks up in the Northeast are looking at me going, are you freaking kidding me? I'm up to my, in snow here. What are you talking about? Well, it's the perfect time for tower maintenance. Before we get into the summer thunderstorm season, of course, if you're in New York and Connecticut, you might want to, you know, wait until the snow melts. But DX Engineering carries towers and accessories to ensure that your antenna system is ready for anything Mother Nature can throw at it. Well, almost anything. Lightning. Ask me how I know. DX Engineering makes it easy to erect your tower with products from American Tower Company. DX Engineering carries the entire line of American Tower products. And, of course, American Tower makes a wide range of sections, bases, brackets, and accessories. And depending on the antenna that you're using, Amorite towers work well in self-supporting guide or bracketed situations. And each section is hot dip galvanized for superior corrosion resistance, and it's double bolted to give you extra strong junctions between the sections. And DX Engineering is also an authorized Rhone distributor. Rhone. Man, you think of towers, you think of Rhone. That means you get access to the entire Rhone line. 45G, 55G, and of course the legendary 25G, which I have about 40 feet of laying in my garage one of these days. Got to put that up. I know where I can get parts. DX Engineering, they carry genuine Rhone accessories like guying hardware, work platforms, anchor rods, anything you need. Also, you can get TBX tower accessories from DX Engineering like sections, bases, and hardware. Rhone TBX and American Tower products are all available separately or in handy prepackaged kits that eliminate a lot of the component matching guesswork, along with handy repair and replacement parts for your existing tower. And if you're trying to securely mount a cross member to a tower face, DX Engineering's Genius clamps are an excellent option. They have hundreds of uses. Any place you need to accommodate a 1 to 2 inch outside diameter tubing clamped at right angles or parallel, that's where these Genius clamps come in handy. You can also visit dxengineering.com for other tower accessories and mounting solutions, including lightning rods. Ask me how I know. And replacement hardware. And the new DX Engineering Advanced Design Thrust Bearing has two key benefits over a standard design. First off, the ball bearings ride on an all-metal surface, not on a seam. Like other thrust bearings, this design promotes longer service life, can handle greater loads than other models, which reduces stress on the rotator and allows rotator servicing without removing your antenna. This new Advanced Design Thrust Bearing fits a 2-inch outside diameter mast and most common tower sizes. Get everything you need for your tower situation at DX Engineering, and you know that they ship faster than anybody else in the industry. If you get your order in by 10 p.m. Eastern, and if it's in stock, and it most likely will be, it'll be on a trek headed your way tonight. I actually got an email from a guy once. He said, you know what? I called up DX Engineering, and I made my order, and literally 5 minutes later, I called him back to change something, and my stuff was already on the truck. 5 minutes. Fastest shipping in the industry. Proven products and expert advice. DX Engineering literally helps you shrink the globe. Request your catalog, and you're going to want to save these when you get them in. I promise you are. I don't throw anything away, but especially DX Engineering catalogs. So request yours or shop online 24/7, 365 at dxengineering.com/hamnation. And of course, you'll see their smiling faces and great big old brains. Well, you won't see their brains, but you can take advantage of the brains in those heads, those smiling faces right in the front, at Dayton, in Xenia. Wrap that around your head. We thank DX Engineering for their support of Ham Nation. We love them up there at DX Engineering. And I believe Dale is with us now. Dale, what's going on, dude?
Hey.
Oh, nice hat. Look at
that
hat.
Good to see you.
Nice hat.
Good information about DX. Had to put the hat on for that. I tell you what.
Of course.
We did want to say, can't say too much about those guys, the support they give you when you ask them a lot of questions. And by golly, about the weekend before last, we buried about 900 feet of their RG 75 ohm direct bury cable and set up our active receiving antenna system or not. With it buried, by golly, hopefully those rodents won't get to it anymore, and we'll be able to keep that thing on the air. I'll tell you what, I was listening and using the remote system on the DX contest that weekend, and it was just amazing. And here in the middle of the night when I can't sleep and get up, by golly, I can sit and listen to the East Coast, talk to three or four people in Australia and hear everybody on that system. So it's just too much. Uses that NCC1 phasing controller. So we loved it. Had to say that. Had to wear the hat. We'll take it off in a second. But right tonight on the video segment, we'll keep it short again. And hey, did you ever wonder how to build a pigtail? Let's jump right in.
Hi, I'm Gary with KB9AIT. I do get the question all the time is, how do you make a pigtail? What I do first is I purchase a 3-foot piece of coax with ends on it. I just take this, put it in the middle, and basically cut it in half. The first thing I got to do is strip off some of this coating. Now, I take off about this much, that's about 2 inches, and I just cut in here a little bit and go all the way around it till I come back to the beginning. And I'm careful not to cut into the braid too much. Then I just take this and I score a line in there, just enough of that piece so I can stick my knife or a finger in there and start peeling that off. And I just peel this off. Now, that's the beginning of it. Now, the next thing I do is I gotta make this braid into a piece of wire. So I just take my fingers and I just start separating it. And this will take a bit, so all I'm gonna do is I'm gonna just peel all these off. And I just keep going around the coax and they separate pretty easy. And that was why I said, be careful when you cut that piece off, that sheathing off, that you don't nick this wire, because if you nick these wires, they'll break off. And you can see it's starting to come out just as pieces of wire now. I'm gonna get this right down to the, close to that black insulation, outer insulation as I can. And you can see I'm just about got it all. Now, as you can see, I'm right down to that insulation. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take all these wires, put them over this side, and I'm just going to twist them together into a wire now. And this is going to be the ground side of your pigtail. Next thing I'm going to do is take a piece off of this. And again, it's the same thing. For this, I just need enough to get this on there. So, as you can see, that's about this much. I'm going to cut about that much off here. And again, it just push the knife into. You just touch the wire. You don't really want to nick the wire till you come all the way around. Separate a little. There it goes. There. Now I'm going to tin. This is the hot side here. I'm just going to tin this. This makes it a little easier, I think, when you start to solder. I'm going to tin this end only because I don't want it to unravel. Seeing it's copper, it doesn't take much to get some solder in there. And I just do the same thing right about here. See if I can get that to just to solidify a little bit. Okay, I got my center conductor and my ground, and I'm going to put some shrink tube over this, like that. I'm going to take my connector, and I put that connector on there. I'm going to take my handy dandy little crimp tool, I'm going to crimp that on there. And then ultimately I will solder that. And I'll take this piece of shrink tube and put it on there. Put this one on here. I'm going to crimp that onto it. There. Now, I'm going to shrink these down with my handy dandy little shrink gun. Okay, the shrink tube is on now. Black is ground. Red is for your center conductor. And all I'm going to do is I'm going to solder this now, and put just a small piece of tape on here. So, okay, there, I've soldered those two ends on. Put a little piece of tape on there, and that's exactly like the one here. And you could just take that and put that on whatever antenna would take these kind of connectors. There's some Yagi antennas that take this. And thanks for watching this video on how to make a pigtail for your antenna. And again, I'm Gary, KB9AIT, and 7-3s.
Well, thank you, Gary. Great demonstration. And we would like to thank our Ham Nation show notes editor, Dan, K9LVS. He created that video with Gary. Well, we've got a few seconds left. And as you know, social media, Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat, those kind of things, would never survive without cat videos. So let's check out the Ham Nation version of a cat's meow, courtesy of Doug, N4YKQ. Hey, Brian, play it again, Sam. And again? Okay. That's enough. We all need a chuckle every once in a while, and thanks to Doug for sending it to us at Ham Nation Videos. And that's it for tonight's special Show Me Your Cat episode and for the video segment. Our segment's here to display your videos and shack photos, so please submit yours. The queue's low. We'd love to feature your video. Just send a link to that video to HamNationVideos at twit.tv. We do prefer you have it somewhere on a site like YouTube where we can link to it for broadcast rather than receiving a huge file. We'll get it on the air for you any way you get it to us, though, so send them in. And that's about it. It's time now to visit Amanda out in Canyon City, find out what's hopping in the chat room. Amanda, welcome. Good evening.
Good evening. How is everyone tonight? Am I the only one that wore green? I can't believe it. I expected Dawn to be wearing green. All right, let's get to it here. Bob, the first question is for you. KD8YQC says, you had said last week to get two 20 microfarad at 450 volt filter caps from Tubes and More. He says, what is the difference between a regular cap and a filter cap?
The same. Just the name they put on it. It's just an electrolytic, and it will become a filter cap. But it's an electrolytic capacitor. That's all it is.
Okay, good enough. And then kind of the next request, basically, is a lot of these folks have been looking for some of these parts that you've been mentioning, and there's such a close indifference to the parts that they could choose. They're hoping that you will list somewhere all of the parts, maybe the part numbers, so that they can find this and build this project themselves. Is that going to happen?
We will do that. I forgot to mention that. Yeah, I got a lot of requests. We'll be doing that when I get a little further along, but what I've listed the parts that you would be safe to go ahead and get those. You'll need those to get started, but we'll continue making the list for the next module, which will be the microphone preamplifier. So just follow the list that I gave you from Antique Electronics and Tubes and More. That'll get you going, and we'll give the whole list. And I'm looking at maybe doing a site somewhere where we'll have all this, because we need to put all this together, because it's I never realized how popular this was going to be, but it certainly is in my life. So we'll help you learn how to build a little bit. So stand by.
All right. Very good. And my next question, you know, this could go to Bob or George, and I bet you both would have an answer. Let's go to you, George. N3KDC says, what's the difference of a 1-4 Balun voltage versus current type, and where do you get them?
Yeah, this is really a Gordo kind of question to me, but, well, I don't have a good answer other than you get them from a lot of different places, MFJ, radio waves, there's just almost everybody. DX Engineering has balance. Bob, how would you quantify the difference between the two?
It depends on who makes them.
Yeah.
I think you're going to be safe with DX Engineering. They've got just about everything. I would vote for DX Engineering. I think you'd probably agree, George.
Yeah. Yeah, I would. And most of the time, we're looking for current balance, I believe, in ham radio. I don't really know how to tell you what the difference is. I guess you could say a 4-to-1 Balun is basically changing the ratio. You know, you're going in with one impedance, you're coming out with another. So,
yeah.
Yep.
Okay, and I'd like to talk about DX Engineering. If you go there looking for some balance, they have an awesome kind of, I'm not exactly sure that it's a frequently asked questions, but it's a real good breakdown of why you want a balance and what you use it for and why you want a certain balance, a 2-to-1, a 4-to-1, whatever. So you guys look for that. They have some great information on them as well. And with that, I have one announcement. Tommy, KF4TC wanted us to know that June, his lovely significant other, just got her license, and that is KN4BQK. So if you hear her on your local repeaters or whatnot, be sure to say hello. So other than that, I don't have any other questions. Let me go over some of the nets tonight. And also a big thanks to Dan for posting to WikiDocs every week. It's always such a great help. You list what we've talked about and add further information. So thank you, Dan, for working on that every week. It's great. Nets. 20 meters, they were trying 14.268. I think it was a flop tonight. You guys can listen around, but I think Steve has pulled the plug on that. 40 meters, 71.92. I hope to hear you all there. D-Star 14 Charlie, Echolink, do drop in, and DMR on TAC 311. So there you go. Don't forget to like us on Facebook, and I'll send it back to you, Bob.
Okay. Well, it's been really fun tonight. I promised you I'd do this. I'll drive you nuts here because I'm going to just rotate this camera a little bit and let you see what's going on here, because I don't know when we'll be back here next. What's happening over there? And they just today finished a whole bunch of there's Pro 7s and the new PR-77. That what happens there, everything gets cleaned up here in the daytime. At the end of the shift, this is where they assemble things after, that's the final assembly, after they come off of the benches. And I'll just roughly go through this. This guy right here, might even be able to zoom in, Brian. They're putting the lights together that will go in the fins. And then the next a bench, they just finished doing the elements, and they're going into PR-22s. And this is Donna's great work. She's the best service director ever. She's been with us for 23, 24 years. She's amazing. And you can ask her just about anything. She's not a ham, but she knows more than most of us. She's something. But that's where it's all built, down that row. Then they come over to this table where they get final. Some of them need clips and all that kind of stuff. Then from there, they go back over here and start getting boxed and finaled. And then out the shipping, you can see some of the cardboard there. And then they'll be either shipped out or put in stock. And there's, four warehouses here now. I have to think because there used to be one. Now we have all kinds of them. So this is pretty much the working heart of Heil Sound. We I have, as I said, all the parts as they come in, different parts from all over the world, and then they're assembled here, final assembled, boxed, and the most important thing, and you'll be able to see it, is after this final assembly, unlike so many companies, if you can see way in the back, there's a JBL speaker mounted in a cabinet back there, and there's every radio in the world underneath there, a type of radio, ICOM, Kenwood, all of it. Every microphone is plugged in and tested. And we have a dummy load on all the radios, and we listen down in a Kenwood receiver down on the bottom. You can't see it from here, but we know they sound good because we've looked at them on all the scopes and stuff like that over there. But the last thing we plug them in, same thing for the pro mics. That's what the speaker is for. We listen because a lot of times it'll look fine on a scope. Everything's fine, but there's just something's not right. And I've got some really good ears around here. They take care of that. So there you are. A short run of Heil Sound in Fairview Heights, Illinois. We're about, oh golly, what are we, 12 miles east of the Great Arch. If I stand on the roof, I can see it. So there you go. We've had a good time. I hope you have. I hope you've learned something. Randy's piece was really good. Please build one of those. And the next thing, go to a ham fest and pick up some of these parts and get you a scope. If you don't have a scope, I saw some here at the last HamFest. I saw some for $25, some for $50. Amazing. I mean, there's just a lot of people have good parts and they just don't need them anymore. You need them. So build that. And then I hope that that you continue on with the Pine Board project. If nothing more, you'll learn to solder. You'll learn to put things together. But make sure you understand we're playing with about 200 to 300 volts, okay? Well, we'll talk to you back here next week. I'll be back in Missouri, I do believe. But until then, thanks for being here, George, Amanda, Don, Dale, all of you. Thanks so much. And Brian, thank you. So 7-3, everybody. We'll see you next week right back here on the Twit Network with Ham Nation.